capture of the British government's secret war in Northern Ireland in the 1980s. We reveal details of a company that agents of the state were involved either directly or indirectly in the murder of its own citizens. We outline the serious questions this raises about the integrity of the criminal justice system, while army agents were allowed to act as judge, jury and executioner. And we ask if in its attempt to criminalise the IRA, the British government succeeded only in criminalising itself.
Why, my fella? He wasn't active. Hadn't been active. I mean, we're one of maybe the biggest Republican families in the area. There's a couple of our big Republican families. I mean, who were still active, which my father wasn't. So, like, why? And who gave him the right to play God?
We want an independent inquiry into the murder, into the allegations of collusion with British military intelligence and the British security forces. We want to find out the truth, why so many people were murdered. We want to know about F.R.U., what their involvement in this whole campaign of murder was, why the security forces decided not to secure the lives of the people but to go out and wreck people's lives.
Basically, we always joked that we flew by the seats of our pants because there were no rules. With the benefit of hindsight, it was a mistake. And it's still a mistake.
This was a policy that had been conducted in Northern Ireland by the British for a long number of years. And that there was a layer underneath that was very dark and very evil, and that was manipulating and deciding how the people in Northern Ireland were to live, or in fact, were they to live, or were they to die?
Governments are ultimately responsible for what their armies do and for what their intelligence services do, even if they build a Chinese wall and pretend that they know nothing about them. In the case of the F.R.U., I think government knew all about it. And must bear the ultimate responsibility for what they did.
So what have you accused of the government directly of doing at that time?
We have said that we believe that through the F.R.U. They were targeting their own citizens for murder.
The British government was responsible for the murder of its own citizens?
Yes.
No, it's certainly the outline to continue to fight terrorism, but within the law. Very, very, very important consideration. Lose everything if you don't, if you abandon those principles. Terrorists are free to work, of course, completely outside the law, but democratic society, we have to work within the law.
On the 9th of October 1987, Francisco Notar Antonio and his wife were in bed at their home in the Ballymurphy area of West Belfast when their front door was burst open. The UFF men appeared to know the layout of the house as they made their way to their target. One of the gunmen, dressed in distinctive blue overalls, shot Francisco Notar Antonio three times, killing him instantly. It was a particularly squalid killing, made more poignant by the fact that the vulnerable old man was still wearing his pyjamas.
They come up the stairs, they went into the very first room, which is the box room. The nephew was lying there. And they pulled the blankets off his head. And he shouts, "I'm F.R.U., I'm not art. I'm F.R.U. O'Brien," that's what he shouted, "I'm not art." And they sort of walked out, went into the girls' room, just took a look, walked straight out, and one stood in the lantern. The other gunman walked in to my mother's bedroom. My mother was standing there. She seen him. She thought he was SAS. And she panicked, you know. She was in sort of shock, like, "What's wrong?" And at that, my father had jumped up. You know, when I say jumped up, out of a sleep, I mean, what's going on? And that's when one was put in his chest. And he sort of spun over. It was two on his back.
The UFF justified the killing by claiming they had murdered an IRA godfather. Despite the fact that the coffin was carried by Jerry Adams, Francisco Notar Antonio, a former taxi driver, had not played an active role in Republican politics for over 40 years. The RUC never found his killers. At Belfast Milltown Cemetery, Francisco Notar Antonio's grave is next to that of a father of two who was murdered by the same UFF gang. Patrick Hamill was shot in the head at his home off the Springfield Road a month before the Notar Antonio killing. Mr. Hamill had no connection with the Republican movement, but was targeted simply because he lived close to the main getaway route for Loyalist killers in West Belfast. As was the case in the Notar Antonio murder, the gunmen showed no mercy as they callously dispensed with their victim in front of his family.
Remember at 20-6, the door opened, two gunmen rushed in, both of them armed, said they were from the Provisional IRA and asked who lived in the house. Pat says Pat Hamill, and I said Pat Hamill, and that's when they shot him. The first one turned around to the second one, and the second one gave him the nod, and he shot him three times. I was horrified. I didn't honestly think that they were going to murder Pat. That wasn't, because the IRA didn't come in and murder people in their own homes in West Belfast, so that wasn't anything that crossed my mind.
Why did Francisco Notar Antonio and Patrick Hamill die? And is it more than coincidence that they were murdered by the same gang of UFF gunmen wearing distinctive overalls? Not according to a damning confidential and potentially explosive report by the human rights group British Irish Rights Watch, detailing collusion between the security forces and the killers. It alleges that both murders are linked, along with at least four others, to a covert campaign of state-sponsored terrorism conducted by a secretive and highly organised section of military intelligence called the Force Research Unit, or F.R.U. Insight has obtained a copy of the report. It alleges that F.R.U.
broke every rule in the book and committed some of the most serious crimes, including conspiracy to murder, collecting and providing information likely to be of use to terrorists, and directing terrorism.
I certainly don't believe that F.R.U. was, in any sense, a maverick organisation or out of control. I do believe that it was an integral part of British Army intelligence, fully integrated into the security services and fully authorised in everything that it did.
Tonight on Insight, we penetrate the clandestine world of counter-terrorism, a world shrouded in secrecy. The British-Irish report formed the basis of a renewed investigation into allegations of collusion when it was presented to the British and Irish governments 2 years ago. But London is resisting its central demand for a full public inquiry until the conclusion of a third police investigation under Sir John Stevens, a situation some suspect acts as a political cover for continued inaction. But the Secretary of State at the time states categorically that there is simply no case to answer.
Well, that was their responsibility. I mean, it's very easy to make allegations of one sort and another, but the rules were absolutely clear. There was never any possible suggestion that the authorization was given to operate outside the law, for the reasons I've given, that we had democratic principles to uphold. Our whole basis and the whole justification for the position of Northern Ireland as part of the United Kingdom, it rests on the democratic wish of the people of Northern Ireland and a democracy under a parliament operating under the law. And I had no authority to operate outside the law. I wouldn't have countenanced it.
Accurate intelligence is the key element in any war, and the British government went to extraordinary lengths to ensure that F.R.U. had the resources it required to prosecute its campaign. Tonight we reveal just how far the government was prepared to go to pursue the IRA with the help of Loyalist gunmen, and ask if the evidence points not to rogue agents or rogue units, but the widespread institutionalised criminality.
I was never given any instructions or shown any manuals which would have indicated that there were any rules, whether they be Home Office rules or not. Indeed, I remember being specifically told that the Home Office rules do not apply to the Army, They applied to the RUC in theatre, but not to the army.
We have obtained detailed information from former members of F.R.U., which would appear to corroborate some of the conclusions reached by the British-Irish report. The picture that emerges depicts an organisation that knew no legal boundaries. From the mid-80s, the operation was under the control of a Colonel Gordon Kerr. Born in Aberdeen, he is now the British government's military attaché in Beijing, a highly sensitive diplomatic posting. He was the central controlling figure in a web of informers and agents. The stated official aim of F.R.U. was to thwart the terrorists. That at least was the rationale used by Colonel Kerr during a court hearing in 1992.
In order we can save life, that we can prevent attacks taking place, that we can prevent assassinations, that we can make arrests, that we can get recoveries of weapons and explosives.
But the campaign went far beyond collating intelligence, according to British-Irish Rights Watch, which suggests
agents of the state have been involved directly and indirectly in the murder of its citizens, in contravention of domestic law and all international human rights standards.
This, it suggests, was sanctioned at the highest levels.
F.R.U. was an integral unit within the intelligence corps, with detailed and clear lines of reporting within the army and clear links with MI5 and Special Branch. F.R.U.'s intelligence was reported to and relied upon by ministers.
F.R.U. emerged from the military's inept handling of intelligence gathering in Northern Ireland at the outset of the Troubles. It came into existence not long after Margaret Thatcher's arrival in Downing Street in 1979 and coincided with the intensification of the criminalisation of the IRA, a policy that succeeded only in fueling Republican support. The IRA's ranks swelled in the face of what many in the Republican community saw as British intransigence and began rebuilding as both a political and military force. The changes were greeted with dismay in both London and Dublin, where interlinked but subtly different concerns came to the surface, leading in time to the creation of the Anglo-Irish Agreement. Mrs. Thatcher and her security advisers saw in the agreement first and foremost the possibility of destroying the IRA through enhanced security cooperation.
Well, it was important to get closer cooperation because obviously the border was too easy for terrorists to pop over one side or other of the border, to store weapons south of the border as well. And so the need for closer cooperation, better cooperation on intelligence, information, that was all part of improving security cooperation and helping the fight against terrorism.
For the Irish government, concerns about London's failure to take into account the political nature of the problem were augmented by an over-reliance on the military as the key policy determinant.
The fact that the army was used in Northern Ireland as a police force meant that the support for the morale of the army tended to dominate policy. I don't think British policy could ever be single-mindedly devoted to solving the Northern Ireland problem, because concern to protect the morale of the army, regardless of what the army were doing, constantly undermined British policy. And what we had to do right from 73 onwards was to try to get the British to rethink their security policy, which was keeping the whole thing going.
But London maintained it was caught in a deadly vice, occasioned by the nationalists' refusal to accept an internal settlement, which unionists maintained provided the political answer, if only the government used its military to crack down on terrorism. Alienation was copper-fastened by the heavy-handed use of the courts to buttress the military's commanding position.
We had to be firm, and if we needed to bring extra troops over, we did increase the number of troops. If we needed to take extra steps, which I did, for instance, in helping the balance of the law, we made changes, for instance, over the presumptions over things like right to silence. That was toughening the law, because it was quite often it was very difficult to get convictions from people who were manifestly guilty of terrorist crimes.
But in the shadows, the British Army, through F.R.U., embarked on a secret strategy to recruit loyalism to its ranks, part of a complex web of informers and double agents. The strategy had a clear rationale. intensifying the conflict against the IRA while distancing the British Army from direct involvement, a strategy which former F.R.U. members suggest also involved the active collusion of RUC Special Branch.
Without the help specifically of the Force Research Unit and the Special Branch, then the Loyalist volunteers would not have been able to tie their shoelaces. They were probably one of the worst prepared, worst trained rabble of men that I ever had the misfortune to ever come across. But nonetheless, the resources of the Force Research Unit, and to a lesser extent the Special Branch, were fueled and funneled towards loyalism.
But there was a problem with the strategy. Could the handlers control those they recruited? And when nakedly sectarian murders were carried out, did they turn a blind eye for political expediency? The linchpin in the operation was Brian Nelson, a former British soldier who the F.R.U. infiltrated into the UDA. Nelson quickly rose to become Chief Intelligence Officer of the UDA before being convicted of conspiracy to murder in 1992. A plea bargain before the case came to open court ensured the true extent of his involvement in F.R.U. remained a secret. Only now is it emerging.
If you took post-Brian Nelson and pre-Brian Nelson, if you looked at the statistics, I think the statistics will bear me out here, and that the attrition from loyalism at random sectarian attacks diminished during Brian Nelson's era. They increased dramatically after the arrest of Brian Nelson. The overall level of attrition was reduced during Brian Nelson's era. Nonetheless, there were still people in that period who died, who needn't have died. When I say needn't, I mean needn't, but nonetheless did. But in the overall picture, in a military sense, that period was a success. An undeniable success.
But at what price? The killings of Francisco Notarantonio and Patrick Hamill are just two of a number of documented cases which raise alarming questions about the methods used by F.R.U., methods more usually associated with Latin America. In the aftermath of Notarantonio's murder, members of his family found a detailed military map which had been dropped by the UFF killers.
They dropped an army map. At first we thought it was one of the kids' homeworks, a map, you know, of their geography homework. But when we had opened it, it was a grafted map. It was colour-coded, and it was from Ballybean, right over to here. It was orange, green and purple.
And what did it show on it?
Well, there was pinpoints from, say, Ballybean up and right through the town would have been purple. That sort of got to the Shankill, Springfield Road there. And when it got to the Catholic part of the Springfield Road, it was in green, right to this address.
And did it show arrows right to the address, or?
It was a green, right to the address.
And did it pinpoint?
Three dots, yes.
And what happened to that map?
We passed it to Sinn Féin. And we've never seen it again. We did ask Sinn Féin for it. They didn't know where it was.
Two further questions emerge from the Notarantonio killing. Why should the intelligence services want his death? And what mechanism allowed army intelligence to effectively direct loyalist targeting? Insight understands Notarantonio's name was passed by the F.R.U. to the UFF via Nelson to protect an IRA double agent. We also understand that F.R.U. suggested the alternative target when it came to its attention that the agent, codenamed Steak Knife, was at risk of imminent assassination.
When you're running agents in the field, sometimes there is an overlap, and in this instance, Brian Nelson was targeting another agent of the Force Research Unit. Yes, an IRA man. Therefore, that was not conducive to the interest of the Force Research Unit. Brian Nelson was in a very good position to, probably with or certainly without knowing it, to deflect the attention away from an individual in this instance, on an agent or onto another chosen prey, which would then render the interest of the F.R.U. back to this normal status quo. To do that, you still have to put somebody else up as the prey. And unfortunately, Mr. Notar Antonio was that prey.
He was thrown to the wolves.
Yes.
By British Army.
Yes.
In order to save a cold-blooded killer, an IRA man, he just happened to be passing information to the F.R.U.
Yes.
If true, this blatantly contradicts the plea of mitigation given by Colonel Kerr at the Nelson trial in 1992, when under oath he proclaimed,
"It was never our intention to initiate procedures at any stage of the game, and from my recollection of the fields, I do not believe that this was the case."
This in turn conflicts fundamentally with a confidential statement given to the Stevens investigation and published in the New Statesman magazine that he had recruited the former soldier to
persuade the UDA to centralize their targeting through Nelson and to concentrate on known para activities.
The way was really, really paved for them. The barricade at the top of Spring Hill at the time, that barricade was open. Normally it would have been closed. So they had a straight run in and out with no obstructions whatsoever.
That is all part of the targeted plan of any operation. The most important part for an attacker is not how I get in, but how I get out. And that, in 9 times out of 10, determines whether the operation goes ahead or not. Therefore, that would have been a very relevant point of any plan, and F.R.U. certainly did help facilitate that type of planning.
An obvious conclusion is that Kerr either perjured himself in open court or misled the Stevens inquiry.
I think once any unit within the security forces has come to the conclusion that in order to save lives, you have to take lives, you are on a very, very slippery slope because you begin to play God. You begin to decide who's going to live and who's going to die. I think that if we, as civilized people living in a democracy, allow those whom we have licensed to kill on our behalf in exceptional circumstances to go down that path and make those sort of decisions, we can expect that innocent people will die. And there is no sensible moral equation that you can make between lives saved and lives lost. The lives that are lost should not have been lost, and would not have been lost if that line had not been crossed.
The suffering of victims was poignantly underscored by Achai's innocence in President Clinton's first visit to Belfast.
My name is Catherine Hamill. My daddy works as an assistant at Stewart's Warehouse. I live in Belfast. I love where I live. My first daddy died in the Troubles. It was the saddest day of my life. I still think of him.
She encapsulated the sense of loss pricking consciences in the process. But like so many of the deaths in the Troubles, the truth behind the slaying of Catherine Hamill's father had deeply sinister overtones. The same gun was used to cut down Notar Antonio. The linkage between the two murders and the pain of a child raised serious questions about the company the army was keeping.
Do you believe now that your husband was singled out for murder by the British Army?
Absolutely.
Do you believe that they decided that he should die?
Absolutely.
For one reason or another?
Whatever reason they had, that's what I want now. I want the truth. I want to know the truth. Did they set him up? Was he part of of this intimidation and the murder of Catholics, innocent Catholics in their own home, to strike fear at the heart of the community, which it did.
This concern singularly informs the British-Irish report. Its findings are unequivocal.
Many leading loyalists were also prime intelligence sources for the intelligence services, and collusion was widespread. In this sense, they were double agents. However, the duality of their role made them difficult to control.
The strategy that was employed, in my opinion, was immoral and probably unlawful.
What was that strategy?
The strategy of using him as a conduit and using the UFF as an extension of the operational capability of the British Army. And by that, I mean refining their targeting, increasing their operational efficiency by rearming them and using them to target known subversives, which fitted the criteria and other type of person that the F.R.U. wanted eliminating.
When Colonel Kerr recruited Nelson, he was clearly exceptionally damaged goods, having been convicted of the brutal torture of a Catholic man in March 1973. Infiltrating people like Nelson was always going to be morally problematic, a fact conceded by Kerr himself when he maintained in court that Northern Ireland was in fact a war arena.
It embarrasses me personally that the system has been unable to recognize the difficulties of running agents within a terrorist organization, has been unable to recognize the dichotomy between terrorist or counter-terrorist situation and a law and order situation. And, as a result, Brian Nelson is a victim of the system to which he was actually very loyal.
I think the Force Research Unit is a despicable unit who have carried out illegal activities. They are run by the British government, who purports to be a model of democracy, and yet when it suits them, they'll flout every law that there is to flout and then deny that they've done it. And they'll condemn others for carrying out illegal activities. And again, I think it's something that needs investigation, and it needs brought to the attention of the public so that they know what sort of society we have been living in for the last number of years.
Former intelligence officers remain loyal to the strategy behind F.R.U., but do now admit to concerns about tactics which ultimately led to F.R.U. deciding who could live or who could die.
You say that you have no problem with 99% of F.R.U.'s activities.
No, I would have no problem with 99% of F.R.U.'s activities.
What is the 1% that you do have a problem with?
The 1% that I would have a problem is to use another terrorist army to attack another terrorist army. I find that morally indefensible.
But you didn't at the time.
I didn't, no. I knew in broad outline what was going on, and I also found the use of individuals to facilitate the death of other individuals in a deceitful way. That's with some degree of control from the army to be abhorrent.
That doesn't seem to be 1%. That seems to be the complete day-to-day operation of F.R.U.
No, it's a very small percentage. Those are only two examples. There are many others who do perform a service to society.
For others, however, it confirms their suspicions that F.R.U. was out of control of the law of the land. The British-Irish report alleges,
"We believe that far from having as its aim the saving of life, the aim was to direct loyalist violence against Republican targets. It was, in effect, a policy of shoot to kill by proxy."
The complex game being played out may never be known in full, but it is clear that the army was engaged in extremely Machiavellian and morally suspect stratagems. One ploy involved the use of double agents. De Brann perceived enemies within the IRA as informers in order to protect their own agents, but also to facilitate a change of direction in the Republican movement.
I think it brought the Republican community to the realization that they couldn't wage war continuously. Well, they had an intense fear of the informer. No, they were well aware that they were penetrated extensively, and that sowed fear and paranoia.
You said one of the tactics that F.R.U. actually used was to give information which would lead the IRA to believe that a certain person was an informer within their own ranks.
Yes. By using your own agents to sow these seeds, and from small acorns grow.
But you knew by doing that that the IRA's penalty for being a former is death?
Yes.
So therefore you were setting someone up for death? Someone who was innocent in terms of being an informer?
Fortunately, I never had to make that decision, but yes, that decision was made on occasions.
Would you understand if I said that many people watching this would say that really F.R.U. were playing a very deadly game with the lives of people in Northern Ireland?
I would agree. They were judge, jury and executioner.
And who gave them that right?
One thing you must remember. Sent them there with no rules. And with the passage of time, are you surprised that they expanded the rule book? Their rule book.
Do you believe the British government has criminalised itself?
I believe that the British government has broken every rule in the book. It has not adhered to domestic law. It has not adhered to international law. It has ridden roughshod over the right to life in a way that would not be acceptable in the least developed country in the third world, never mind in a developed democracy which holds itself up as an example when it comes to human rights to other countries.
But it is the allegation that F.R.U. was centrally involved in the murder of an officer of the court in 1989 that raises the most disturbing questions for military intelligence. The murder of Pat Finucan shook Northern Ireland's judicial system. And the political implications of the murder of a prominent solicitor resonate today as strongly as ever. But it's a murder that implicates not only the Force Research Unit, but also raises uncomfortable questions about the RUC Special Branch, its knowledge of the targeting of Pat Finucan, and its failure to apprehend his killers. Tracing the role of both organisations suggests just how far each had departed from the stated objective of upholding the rule of law and protecting citizens from assassination. Pat Finucan was one of the most high-profile lawyers operating in Northern Ireland. His success in defending IRA suspects clearly enraged the British authorities. Following a briefing by the then RUC Chief Constable Jack Herman, an extraordinary exchange occurred in the House of Commons when Junior Home Office Minister Douglas Hogg said, in his opinion, a number of Northern Ireland solicitors were unduly sympathetic to the IRA. Some regarded Hogg's intervention as a clear incitement to murder, with Pat Finucan in the firing line. 4 weeks later, UFF gunmen walked into Finucan's home off the Antrim Road and shot him dead in front of his wife and children.
I think just in the few weeks before he was actually killed, he was shocked because of Douglas Hogg's statement. But I don't think he really believed that as a lawyer he would actually be murdered for doing his job.
Undoubtedly, Mr. Finucan was regarded as a thorn in the side of the authorities when alive. But the consistent questioning about his death has ironically made him potentially even more troublesome now. From the start, his family believed there was collusion.
When Pat was murdered, we literally started to ask questions. Over the next few years, small pieces of the jigsaw began to come to light. Now, although the pieces were very small and certainly didn't give a very clear picture, what was emerging right from the very beginning was the murky evil that had been going on.
The former Chief Constable John Herman, writing in the Daily Telegraph 2 years ago, still maintained without proffering any evidence that Mr. Finucane
was associated with the IRA, and he used his position as a lawyer to act as a contact between suspects in custody and Republicans inside.
We understand that the Stevens inquiry team now has information which proves that Brian Nelson did compile a dossier on Pat Finucane prior to the murder. Sources within F.R.U. say that that information was given to Nelson and that he was actually taken on scouting missions of the Finucane home by his intelligence handlers, although that cannot be proven. Similar questions surround the activities of Special Branch. It's alleged that named Special Branch officers actually suggested to the UDA that they kill the prominent solicitor. One uniformed officer has told the Stevens inquiry that a known UDA man admitted to his role in the murder, but he was told not to pursue it. 3 months ago, Mrs. Finucane travelled to Downing Street to press home her demands for a full judicial inquiry, but there remains little immediate prospect of this, certainly not in advance of the Stevens team reporting its findings. There has been speculation that the police ombudsman could potentially use retrospective powers to investigate Pat Finucane's death. Critics, however, including crucially the Finucane family, the SDLP and Sinn Féin, all say this fails to address the issue, an issue that goes far beyond tactics and towards strategy. British Irish Rights Watch say only a full inquiry has the potential to answer the key questions.
The murder of Patrick Finucane was a product not of an isolated act of collusion, but of a systematic strategy. F.R.U.'s actions amounted to state murder by proxy.
Police investigations can only look at matters of crime. They can look at an individual murder and say, who did this? And can we bring this person to book? They cannot look at the wider questions, such as, was this, as we say it was, a deliberate policy that was sanctioned by government? That is not an issue that Sir John Stevens or his team can interest themselves in legitimately. And that, to us, is in many ways a rather more burning question than who pulled the trigger.
No representative from the British government was prepared to comment on the issues raised by this programme. But international pressure at the highest stage could prove considerable in forcing the Prime Minister's hand. Prior to his valedictory address at the Odyssey Arena last month, President Clinton attended a private meeting with Mrs. Finucane, who handed over a copy of the British Irish Rights Report. Mrs. Clinton has expressed acute interest in the case, and a visit to the United States at the new Democratic Senator's request to coincide with the anniversary of Mr. Finucane's death is imminent. Insight has also learned that the UN Special Rapporteur on extrajudicial state killings will raise the British Irish Watch report with the Prime Minister in the coming weeks. Any move is likely to face stiff opposition from those who argue that the simple reality remains that the ends did justify the means.
We had some successes in terms of fighting back against terrorism at that time, which I think contributed to eventually people beginning to understand, but also the political development of the Anglo-Irish Agreement, that the future of Northern Ireland wasn't going to be settled by violence and fighting and holding the line, stopping the terrorists winning, making them sit down also and realise that we need to look at this and realise that actually in the end, only by a democratic resolution were these problem's going to be solved.
But for some, it has led to profound questioning about the very nature of society and the price paid to fight terrorism.
I believe that there should be a properly constituted inquiry set up which would address the issues at hand with the powers to investigate. It isn't for me to say whether anybody should be prosecuted or indeed charged or indeed found guilty, but it is only right and proper that we address as a society the issues at heart here. And if there is nothing wrong, then we have nothing to fear. I believe we do have something to fear, but nonetheless we need to address it so as the wounds can be cauterized. Otherwise, they are going to fester and fester, and we need to address the problem which is before us, not only in the Finucane case, but in other cases as well.
I believe there has to be a public inquiry eventually into the work of the F.R.U. because it raises questions about what kind of a country we live in and who is running the country that we live in. And in a situation where members of the security forces can target their own citizens for murder, unless these questions are answered, unless they're asked in the first place and then proper answers are obtained, this sort of thing can happen again. And I don't want to live in a country like that, and I don't think that most people living here want to live in a country like that either.
Well, I'll just cut them away. A wee bit of justice.
Do you think a public inquiry is what needed into the whole force research unit?
Definitely a public inquiry is needed to the fullest. Because when they call it a dirty war, it is. I've done a wee bit of research on the fellow's murder. I've investigated a wee bit, and it is a dirty war. And it doesn't get any easier, it just gets harder.
It's always very hard when you lose somebody. Why someone had seemed fit for them to be taken away from you so violently for no reason. If you witness any gunman coming in last and shoot the person that you love, it's devastating. Nobody, unless you've gone through it yourself, can't even begin to imagine how hard it gets.
We may never know the true extent of the secret war fought in the shadows, but the lid is being slowly prized off. What lies beneath is a murky world in which truth is corrupted and confidence in the rule of law shaken to the core. Imposing limited stability on a divided society, it appears, necessitated a clear choice between law and order.